One of the things I was thinking about, you know, I'm going to talk for about 45 minutes, and then maybe I'll just pick randomly two people to summarize what I've said for the 45 minutes. You feel excited by that, do you? Do you feel thrilled? You know, what an amazing challenge. Do you tell children that about examinations? Examinations are an amazing challenge. They're an excitement, they're an adventure. No, you don't. You don't. And you understand, how can we inspire children with a love of challenge and a love of risk-taking if we don't do it ourselves? You know, 90% of adults dread public speaking. Toddlers have no difficulty with public speaking, right? No, Freud puts it very well. He said, how can you understand the radiance of a child's mind and the feeble-mindedness of adults? What happens? What happens between when the child shines and the adult goes into darkness? And what happens is story. And every one of us in this room has a story. And we need to know our own story if we're really to help children with their stories. And when a child comes to you at age 3 or age 5 or whatever, that child has a story and you may have no idea of what that story is. And as Gordon said, that story starts within the womb. Doesn't start when the child is born, it starts in the 9 months within the womb. There was an amazing, or is, I think he's still alive, Frank Lake. Frank Lake really studied a child in the womb and came to the very clear conclusion that at the moment of conception, there is an individual present. And that individual begins to protect itself when any danger comes within the womb or outside the womb, that they pick it up through the umbilical cord. Because we know when mother is under stress that the child picks it up. There's a lovely photograph, I'm a twin myself, of twins in a womb. And mother was under a lot of pressure and stress, and each child has the thumb in the other child's mouth, actually comforting each other. Lovely, another lovely image of a needle going into the womb and the child's hand just directs it away from itself. That's so clever, right? So, when the child comes out of the womb, the story really starts then. But it has started before that. Interesting about Frank Lake, he spent his whole life studying the child in the womb. Now, the womb is a lake. You wonder about names sometimes, wouldn't you? And then another wonderful psychoanalyst called D.W. Winnicott, he spent his whole life studying the child in the cot. You wonder about names. My name is Humphreys. I spend my whole life freeing myself and freeing others from what happened in the early years of life. Because the imprisonment starts there. Not that any parent or any teacher or any educator wants to block the progress of any child. But when we're blocked inside of ourselves, when we have not resolved our own inner conflicts and our insecurities and our fears and our doubts, when we dread public speaking, when we think examinations measure our worth or our value, we are blocked when we don't have a sense of our immense lovability and our individuality and our sacredness as human beings. How can we actually effectively rear children? You see, the future of society never lies with children. The future of society always lies with adults because children have to survive us. And in their surviving us, they build up their walls. They build up their masks because it is very difficult for a child to be real in a situation where a parent or a teacher is in shadow. So for me, I run 3 courses in University College Cork, and we do 2 outreach in Dublin. First course is a whole year course on just looking at yourself, getting to know yourself. Ala Socrates, know yourself. Ala Buddha, you can travel the entire world and not find anybody more deserving of love than yourself. Allah Christ, you love God with all your heart and you love your neighbor as yourself. Allah psychology, the most important thing is your relationship with yourself. And it is the most neglected aspect of education. I mean, you take the present recession. Recession arises because of dark forces. There were powerful emotional processes that led to the recession, but none of them have been looked at yet. Avarice, greed, depersonalization, bullying, target-fixated mentality, addiction to success, de-individualizing, the whole suffocation of individuality within the banks, within the financial institutions, within government was huge. And when you suffocate the individual, you create a major recession. And nobody else has stood up, neither banker, nor politician, nor property developer, and said, mea culpa. So the future of society lies with you and I. And as a psychologist, I need to continue to look at myself and evaluate, where am I coming from? Am I coming from a solid interiority? John O'Donoghue puts that so well, that one, not the politician, I can assure you. John O'Donoghue, the wonderful spiritual writer who died very young at age 53. But he puts it well, to find that solid interiority from which nobody can distance, exile, demean, or lessen your presence in any way. How many of us are in that place? How many of us can stand up in front of a group of people and be independent of how they see you and just speak your own truth? But one of the hardest things for us to do as adults is to speak the truth, because the truth was dangerous to speak as children. I was at one of my favorite restaurants. I'm so kind of taken by the toys. I had no toys as a child. You know, at age 5, I was the parent in the family because my mother was an invalid. I never remember playing as a child. And I have such an intense, attraction to playing. No wonder I do, because I didn't get to play as a child. And I didn't get to be an adolescent either, because I started work when I was 14. Different times, different pressures, different stories. Anyway, this restaurant I go to is down outside Kinsale in Cork. And favorite restaurant of mine, and I know the owners quite well there. And their two adolescent daughters, met them a few times, but there was a six-year-old I had never met. And the mother had told me about her, but I hadn't met her. So one this particular day, I went down with my wife and a friend for lunch, and we were inside in the kind of drawing room area where they would come in and take the order, and there were a lot of people there. And this six-year-old comes up, she's, how she found the only psychologist in the children are geniuses, you know, absolutely ingenious. She comes up to me and she says, I hate school. Now, one of the very important things about children are always communicating. Through every behavior they show, they are communicating something about themselves. And what is very important, when they communicate, they are not talking about you. They are not trying to make life difficult for you. They're trying to show how difficult life is for them. And is there any mature adult out there who will spot what is going on? That's the issue. Let me say that again. When children are troubled and troubling, they are not trying to make life difficult for you or I, but they are trying to show how difficult life is for them. And is there any mature adult who's in that solid place with the eyes to see, the ears to hear, and the heart to feel, to discover what is the child communicating? I mean, Chomsky used to say, when the child is ready, the teacher appears. Actually, the child is always ready. Where's the teacher? The child is always ready to learn. But very often, the teacher doesn't spot it. And so what we do, we blame the child when the child is ready. The child is always ready. The child is eager to learn. You look at toddlers. They are so eager to learn. They have so much energy. They are risk takers. They are daredevils. And they'll tell you around 18 months, me, 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 I do. They tell you how powerful they are and how intelligent they are and how radiant their minds are. But are you in a place to hold them where they are? And to take their communication that I want to be self-reliant, I want to be independent, I want to learn age-related to stand on my own two feet. Because that's, if we give them that, then they become the adults that actually will bring maturity to this world. There's a lovely saying by Confucius, to put the world in order, we must first put the nation in order. To put the nation in order, we must first put the family in order. To put the family in order, we must cultivate our personal life. We must first set our hearts right. My God, 3,000 years ago, Confucius. Nothing has changed. And we still miss that fundamental issue. We must set our own hearts right before we can understand the hearts and minds of children. The mind without heart is not mind at all. But equally, the heart without mind is not heart at all. We need to operate both from our heads and our hearts. That's maturity, that's fullness. And relationship is about bringing my completeness to another. It is not having a child completing my life. You know, many women I've worked with over the years will say, I'm nothing without a child. I'm not complete without a child. Or I'm not complete without a man. Well, that illusion goes very quickly, doesn't it? But they have that notion. You are complete in yourself. You are amazingly complete. You have such a wonderful wholeness. And what you need, relationship is about bringing that wholeness and completeness to another, whether to a child, whether to a partner, whether to a colleague, whether to a friend. Do you bring completeness or do you bring emptiness? And when you bring the emptiness, I know you do it unconsciously. I know you don't do it deliberately in any way to try and make the other person fill your emptiness. But many parents want children to fill their emptiness. Many teachers want children to fill their emptiness by getting the high results. Many managers in workplaces want workers to work so hard so that they can be successful and fill their emptiness with success. Because one of the great addictions nowadays is the addiction to success. And since the recession, the suicide rate has gone up 30%. And I've worked with men, you know, who say, my life is over, my life is finished. Can you imagine? Their life was finished when they were small children, when they learned very, very young. When you work, you please me. No, it's your presence that pleases me. It is your presence that I'm in awe of. Work is just a way of exploring your world, but it doesn't make you more worthwhile. But many of us learned that lesson. I remember that with a man who came to me in his early 40s, and he was a workaholic. He was a farmer, a large farmer. And I called him my haymaker. And not only did he make hay when the sun shined, right? He also made hay when the moon shined. He never stopped working. And if he was eating a meal, he'd walk eating his meal because he had to be getting back out to the fields and back out to the cattle or whatever. He remembered when he came because in his early 40s, his wife had run off with a lover with her one child. Now, you tend to marry the opposite to yourself. Don't go too deeply into that right now, right? But if he was the haymaker, he married a holidaymaker. How absolutely brilliant, right? I mean, he marries the person, he needs to learn about leisure and pleasure, and she needs to learn about the value of work. There's a wonderful golden mean between extremes. Anyway, she goes off on 3 sun holidays every year. He never takes a holiday. She comes back wonderfully tanned, but on one of these holidays, she meets a lover, because, see, her husband is never there for her. But then she's not there for herself either. He comes now, and he's deeply depressed, and he's suicidal, and he says his life is over. And I said, can I tell you, this is the first day of your life. This is the first day, not the last day. Because you're going to discover that your life stopped a long, long time ago, and you have an opportunity in this major crisis in your life to now discover what happened to you as a child. And what we discovered, his father was a workaholic. And they were out in a tractor one day. Did you ever see kids up in tractors with their dads? You see the little chest swelled out, right, with pride. And I'm up here with my dad, right, and it's great, right? And they're going by a golf course. Donegal golf courses, great golf courses, right? And the father starts giving out yards about these crowd of bloody wasters in there, wasting good land and good time and good money. And the kid is there looking up at his dad, and he never wants his father to say what? You're a waster. You're a waster. And he learns now very cleverly, very ingeniously, if I work and work and work, I hold my father's attention. But the sadness of that, the attention is for work and not for himself. And the door is closed very subtly to his development. But now, in his early 40s, the crisis, every crisis is opportunity. And there's an opportunity to bring to consciousness what we locked away in our unconscious as children. Oh, happy crisis. Anyway, the story. You totally forgot the story. Sarah. Sarah is the little girl, right? So Sarah says to me, I hate school. And I said, oh, tell me more about that. Well, Mr. Murphy is very cross, right? And he expects us to have manners, but he had no manners himself. Now, the child is speaking the truth, by the way. This is the child's truth. Why is she picking a stranger and a psychologist at that within her parents' work setting. Why did she need to go to me? So we're chatting away, and I'm discovering about her unhappiness. I mean, any child that says to me, I hate school, I have major concerns. I've seen so many children, their school learning stopping at such an early age because nobody picks up and nobody sits with them. And you sit with a child, by the way. You don't talk to a child, you don't talk at a child, you talk with the child. Bit like Gordon was saying, when they sat with the children say, what are we doing in here? We want to be outside. And so you discover children know exactly what is going on for them. But very few people sit, we say, oh, that's what's wrong with the child. I think he's going, you know, he's been a bit of change, or he's a bit upset, or maybe he ate something. And you're making all these wild guesses rather than sitting with the child, and the child will tell you. When you talk to a child, you're giving advice. Advice, right? They used to have vice principals in schools, as if some evil was going on in schools that needed to be dealt with. To give advice is an evil. It is much better that you help children to discover their own answers, and they know them, and they'll tell you. If you talk at children, if you're not good, what's going to happen to you? Your life is going to be ruined, right? And we'll all be up in jail because of you. You know that preaching? You're up in the pulpit, and the child is getting terrified because you're threatening him. But if you talk with the child, he feels an equality. He feels a sense of understanding. And Gordon was talking about compassion. I was delighted when I heard the word compassion. Because compassion, he was saying, what does compassion mean? Compassion means, I never lose my relationship with you. You are always lovable in my eyes. No bit of behavior takes away from your lovability. You take Bin Laden. He was one of 50 children. His father had 50 children. Do you know that? He was invisible. He found a way to be visible. I'm not justifying his behavior, but what I'm saying to you, if we don't understand human behavior, just shooting him doesn't resolve anything. Because there are many Bin Ladens out in the world who have been invisible as children. And when you're invisible, you'll find a way to be visible. And he found a powerful way to be visible. And I have heard no understanding of that coming from America or coming from any place else. Children do not come out of the womb waving a machine gun or a knife or wanting to murder anybody. That lovely film, The King's Speech. Anybody see it? Please see it. It's a wonderful film, right? And the one great line in that King's Speech film, when the speech therapist says to the king or the future king, you did not come out of the womb with a stammer. How apocryphal he was. Remember, his father was so hypercritical. He could never get anything right for his father. And so the stammer became an evidence of his intense fear of his father and his fear of being criticized and judged. But no, only the speech therapist spotted it and began to support him, and eventually he began to speak. When I'm talking to Sarah, mother comes in. Sarah, what are you doing? And you can't be talking to the guests like that. And I said, mother knows me, right? And I said, Karen, your daughter and I are having a conversation. Please don't butt in. You know, how often do we champion children? Because it takes the world to raise a child, not just parents. And very often parents are not in a place to rear children, because they need rearing themselves. And many of us as adults need to rear our own child. Because, I mean, I spent my 30s rearing my own child that wasn't reared because my mother wasn't there and my father was always absent. So I had to rear my own child. And how many of you have reared your own child? Because if you haven't reared your own child, you're not ready to rear another one. But are you conscious of that? So I said to mother, please butt out, we're having a conversation. I champion the child. I'm not going to now have the mother silence this child's communication, because now I'm not being there for the child. It takes the world to raise a child. Anyway, later on, I'm leaving the restaurant, and the mother comes up to me, and she says, you know, she said, Tony, Sarah's a bit of a drama queen. And I said, no smoke without fire. No smoke without fire. And I said, any child, like I said earlier, who hates school, I have major concerns about. And I'm going to be back in a month's time, and I'm going to ask how Sarah is getting on. Now what am I doing? I'm now actually creating a lifeline for Sarah. She has picked me out, and she picked me out very wisely, and I'm not going to let her go. I have a child at the moment, right, whose aunt is coming to see me for many years, really, because she's one of the most abused children I've come across. Her niece, the whole pattern is repeating. By the way, when I work with children, or adolescents, or adults, I can trace the origins of the behaviors they're presenting back 5, 6, 7 generations. Not because of genes, but the Levi's or Wranglers or Armani, right? Not because of genes, but because emotional baggage goes from one family to another family to another family to another family. And unless somewhere along that generation line, somebody stops and reflects and asks the questions, why do I worry about what other people think about me? What an important question to ask. Because it's the most common addiction of all, addiction to what other people think. Now, as children, we needed to worry about what other people thought about us, because very often what they thought about us wasn't very kind. And so we needed to watch out for the dangers. As an adult, I need to return to people what belongs to them. Because what another person says doesn't belong to you, it belongs to the person that says it. Return to sender. But you see, are you in that solid place to do it? Or do you interject it? And thinking, oh, I'm no good, I'm useless, I'm worthless, nobody would want me, I'm always making a mistake, I'm always letting myself down. Because if you do, you're letting yourself down. And you need to look at, how is it that I don't stay separate from what another person says and stand solidly in my own worth and value and intelligence and creativity? We are amazing as human beings, but we bury it. We bury it so deeply. And you and I, you know, as, you know, people who want to help children, we need to start with ourselves. All parenting starts with parenting yourself. All therapy starts with my doing therapy with myself. Isn't it fascinating? The only profession that's required to actually constantly look at how you are in yourself is psychotherapy and psychoanalysis. It makes no sense to me. The most important profession of all is parenting. There is no more important profession than parenting. Parenting is rocket science. It is not instinctual. Look at the responsibilities that parents have for the physical development of children, the sexual, the emotional, the intellectual, the educational, the social development of children, the creative development of children, the behavioral development of children, and the spiritual development of children. And you can do that by instinct? No, you need to know yourself very deeply. And be sure, have you come into your fullness in all of those capacities? Physical, emotional, social, sexual, and so on. Or do you still have a lot of doubts and fears around them? Because if you do, unconsciously, you will operate out from those boxes. And it will block your effectiveness as an educator, as a therapist, as a parent, as a teacher. Our first requirement, our first responsibility is to know ourselves. Sort out ourselves first. Like Confucius said, put our own hearts right first before we dare take on the responsibility for the heart of another and the mind of another. A month later, I returned to the restaurant. Always follow through what you're going to say, by the way. Don't say something you're not going to follow through on, because children learn not to trust us then. Lo and behold, right, as I walked towards the door of the restaurant, remember now, I'd never seen Sarah before. Who comes out the front door but Sarah? I mean, talk about synchronicity. So she comes towards me and I say, hi, Sarah. Hi. You know, six-year-olds. I said, how are things? And she looks me directly in the eye and she says, things are fine. And she goes off. No conversation. She's done her job. So I go into the restaurant. And later on, mother comes up to me and she said, we had a situation here about a week after you left. And I said, what happened? She said, well, you were here on the Sunday and Sarah went to school fine on the Monday. But the following Monday, she point blank refused to go to school. There was no way she was going to go to school. And you know, when six-year-olds dig in their heels, they can be so powerful. Mother had remembered what I said. Speak with the child. Please speak with the child. Discover what's... Tell me, how is it that you don't want to go to school? That's the lovely question. How is it that you don't want to go to school? What transpired on the Friday, the child tells her, she's a little bit of a chatterbox, right? Now, it's a bit like the preschool children saying to Gordon, we want to be outside. Children need to chat. Oh my God, I mean, look, at getting people back after coffee is such a major exercise because you have so much stuff to chat about. You know, I lecture so much, and to start off is very difficult because people they're chatting away, which is wonderful. People are connecting with each other. Children need chat times in schools. Let's have a chat time. Not always silence and order, right? I taught primary and secondary school myself, and I wouldn't mind, when I taught primary and secondary school, I had lots of difficult issues that I hadn't resolved for myself. But I was regarded as a nice teacher. God, if I was nice, I don't know what the rest of them were doing. Because I had major issues, which I wasn't conscious of at the time, by the way. If I was, I wouldn't do it. None of us, when we're conscious of our fears and our doubts and insecurities, will actually take them out on another. It's when we're unconscious, we put them out there in order for them to be seen. Try to remember what I said. If a child is troubled and troubling, they're trying to get their interior worlds, the trouble in their interior world seen. Equally, when a parent is troubled and troubling, they are equally trying to get their difficulties seen by some mature adult out there. The same with if a teacher is troubled and troubling, they are also trying to get some mature adult out there to spot what's going on for them and offer the support for them to come into the truth. You know, I was talking to 300 Catholic school principals recently, and I was saying to them, what's the most common phenomenon at a staff meeting? What's the most common phenomenon at a staff meeting? Silence. Silence. Passivity. How can you have progress in an organization if we're not talking with each other? And then I said to them, because they agreed with that, I said, if your staff now are silent at a staff meeting, do you actually now say to them, I really would like to hear from each one of you. I really want to get to know what your ideas are, what your fears are, what your aspirations are, what your vision for this school is, what kind of needs that you have yourself, or any grievances. I really want to hear from each one of you. Did they? No. And I said, you need more help now than the people who are passive. It's very important to see that. Because if I, as a leader, don't actually, you know, create the safety, and Gordon again talked about the safety, the emotional safety, the intellectual safety, the social safety for people to speak. I need to look, how is it that I'm not creating that safety? And equally, if I walk down the corridor of a school and I hear children or teachers shouting at the Freudian slip, teachers shouting at children, do I actually now see that that teacher is shouting out for help? Or do I walk by? And when I walk by, I neglect myself, I neglect the teacher, and I neglect the children. And one of the great things about children is how many, there are so many passive bystanders that do not champion children. But there are also so many passive bystanders that do not champion adults. And when we do, we're doing it unconsciously. But nonetheless, who now challenges that Catholic school principal? Who's above him that can say, listen, how is it that you're not, we're back to the how question, how is it that you're not doing that? So, on the Friday, Sarah was chatting in the classroom with her friend. Da-da-da-da. And the teacher says, the male teacher, by the way, where are all the males? I mean, we talk about very few females being in politics. How is it that there are so few males in childcare? I mean, it's fascinating that we need more males in childcare and we need more females in politics. But both need to be... Okay, a few men down there. Yeah, I was able to count you in my hand, right? I couldn't count all the women in my hand now. And what I found fascinating, there were four men up here, one woman, and there were 300 women down there and five men. And you see, we have a very deep question to ask. And I mean this in the best possible way. how is it that we rear our male children into having difficulties working in affective areas? Why is that? And you know, the reason is when there are affective issues to be dealt with within the family, somebody to be comforted, some crisis to be dealt with, where are the boys? Where are they? They're out playing football in the backyard. Where are the girls? They're inside doing all the comforting. And we need to make sure that we give male children the opportunities to develop their feminine side as well as their masculine side. And we need to give female children the opportunity to develop their masculine side as well as their feminine side. And we're still distinguishing between how we rear males and how we rear females. We need to rear our children into completeness, into wholeness, so they operate from both mind and heart. And you know, what's the disease that most men get? Heart disease. And what's the most common operation that men get? Bypass operations. And what do they do with their hearts? And when affective emotional issues arise, they bypass. It's like Spaghetti Junction, right? They're bypassing. And some men have to get open heart surgery before they open up their hearts. And why is it that women get so much breast cancer? Because women are so poor at nurturing themselves. And do they now have to get breast cancer to nurture themselves, to attend to their own breasts? Illness is not a tragedy. Illness is a messenger about things we don't do for ourselves. And it brings us our attention very powerfully to it. We are creators. We are not victims as human beings. Anyway, Sarah. You see, you think I forget the story, but... Sarah's chatting away and the teacher says, Sarah, now, tone of voice accounts for most human problems. Let me say that again to you now. Tone of voice accounts for most human problems. And when you're dealing with a child who's upset or who's throwing a temper tantrum, please look at your tone of voice, because your tone of voice will mirror your own interiority. Because if the child's temper tantrum is about the child, it is not about you. But you see, if you're worried about what other people think and you're in the middle of the supermarket and that cry, that child, and you're embarrassed by what other people think, your tone of voice will change, not because of the child is throwing the temper tantrum, but because you're worried about what other people think. But you blame the child. You've embarrassed me, right? You've shown me up. But actually, what has been shown up is your dependence on what other people think. Because if you're independent of what other people think, you'll say to the child, I understand you would love to have that chocolate bar, but the answer is no, and I'm going about my business now. And you'll do it kindly, and you do it firmly, and you go about your business. And I can assure you the child will trot after you. He may try another bit, but keep trotting. Anyway, tone of voice. The other thing that really is a threat to children's progress is facial expression. Because, you know, do you ever watch babies? Oh my God, they study your face so much, don't you? And do you know that at the moment of birth, children have more brain cells than at any other time in their lives? And it again, Gordon was saying, I was so impressed by Gordon, because he was speaking a language that we know, that, what was I going to say? In the first year of life, children learn more than any other time of life, and they're not in school yet. Children are always learning. They never stop learning. And, well, I'll come to another story in a second. Anyway, Sarah. Sarah, don't come to school on Monday. So Monday comes, I'm not going to school. Why would I go to school? I don't want to go to school. And so Mother discovers that Sarah now doesn't want to go to school because of the teacher shouting. Now remember, that teacher is shouting out for help. He's not trying to intimidate the child. He's trying to show that I'm not coping here and I need help and support to cope. And I was saying to the mother, please, when you go down and talk with any professional, whether preschool, any educator of children's development, right? Please understand that they have a story and be sensitive to story. And don't go and talk at them. What are you doing to my child? And don't talk to them. You know, what you need to do is... talk with them. And the with was, listen, Sarah is terrified of coming to school because of your shouting. And we need your help and support. Both father and mother went down. We need your help and support to actually make it safe for our daughter to be in school. Now, my experience with teachers, I've done a lot of work with teachers over the years, is that once you approach them in that kind, caring, compassionate way, 99% of them respond. And of course, a month, a couple of weeks later, when I come in and I meet Sarah, and Sarah says, things are fine. And things were fine. The teacher had totally changed his relationship with Sarah and with the other children in the classroom. Tell me, who was the mature person there? Was it Sarah? Was it the teacher? Was it the mother? Was it the father? Who? Sarah. Sarah was the mature person. Children speak the truth. Adults have huge difficulty speaking the truth. Now, I like the word belong, right? Because it has lots of meanings. And obviously, to belong. Or to be longing for. Or my belongings. Or what belongs to me and what belongs to you. So lots of play on the word belong, right? A child may be longing for love. They may be longing for recognition. They may be longing for success. They may be longing for a friend. If they are, it means their longings have not been met. The most important need of a child is to belong, right? And Carl Jung puts it very well. Unconditional love corresponds to the deepest longing of every child, but also of every adult. Because when we unconditionally belong, we are so secure and we can explore the world from that safe, secure, solid base of being loved for ourselves. It's important to see that unconditional love is where you love the child for itself, for its amazing presence, for its individuality. You do not confuse the child with a bit of behavior. But you see, many children learn that they're loved for behavior and not for themselves. And that's the big mistake and the relentless recurring of that mistake, that we confuse ourselves with behavior. And like I said, many men confuse themselves with work. I am my work. And a high percentage of them die quite soon after retiring from work. And they'll tell me, now, obviously, before they die, right? They'll tell me, I have nothing left to live for. How sad. How absolutely sad that they confuse themselves with work. Many people confuse themselves with success. Many people confuse themselves with an examination result. We had a situation in Cork where a Leaving Cert student, got the results come out for some odd reason on the 15th of August every year, the day of the assumption, right? There has to be something to do with assumption there, right? 15th of August, the Leaving Cert results come out. She gets 540 points in her Leaving Cert. How's that, by the way? You're a bit disappointed, are you? You kind of, both parents said it's not good enough. And they insist that their daughter returns and she goes back to Leaving Cert the following September that to bring up the points. She now realizes I'm an examination result. I'm not love for myself, I'm only love for what I bring in terms of an examination result. Every child needs to be told, you're not an examination result. An examination is an adventure, you know? It's a bit of fun. It's just an examination only, you know, examines the knowledge of a few questions. That's all. It doesn't examine all the wonderful knowledge that you have. It is so limited. But by God, we take examinations as if they measured our worth or our value or our intelligence or even our knowledge. And they don't do any of that. But many children starting exams now will go in fear and terror because they think they are examination results. And they get that from us as parents, as educators, as teachers. I mean, when I work, when the adults come on the various courses that I do in UCC, I do three courses. I was saying to you, the first course is on personal development, a whole year on looking at yourself. The second course is a two-year diploma on parent mentoring. And it trains people who've done the personal development to now work with parents in terms of one-to-one work, as well as giving parenting courses for children and rearing teenagers as well, and on sexuality as well. And the third course is on relationship mentoring, which is going out beyond the family, into the school, into the workplace, into the political chambers, right? And looking at the maturity of relationships within those settings and doing one-to-one work with people in those settings, particularly managers and leaders, and also providing courses on relationship development within our communities, within our workplaces, God, within our churches, so that they are of a mature nature. You can see where I'm coming from. I'm back right to Confucius. You know, you start with the nation, you start with the community, you start with the family, but most of all, you start with yourself. I was telling some story. What was it? What was it? Exam results. Something else going on in my mind there. It's gone. Anyway, yes, the belonging. The unconditional belonging. Now, you see, you can only tell a child. What do you remember? Every child needs to be loved by every adult they encounter. If the child, you know, gets any hint that they're not loved, they will go into protection. I mean, I have this child, I drifted away from that earlier on, whose aunt comes to see me, and she has been very much verbally and physically violated in the family. The whole thing is repeated within the family. The aunt witnesses this, but she's not in a solid place to champion the child. The child knows that the aunt comes to see me, so she's began to write, this is over 5 years, she writes me little notes. I send her birthday cards, I send her Christmas presents, right? She sends me back lovely cards. She tells me that she loves me and she's never met me. But she knows she has a lifeline. And she says, I'm going to see that man sometime, right? Children know when they have a champion, like Sarah coming into the room and picking out the person that would champion her. Children have amazing intelligence and intuition. Please don't doubt their intelligence, because they're very often 10 miles ahead of you. They know you often better than they know themselves. And remember I was saying to you about facial expression. Babies study us all the time. And I had a baby I was working with last year, 6-month-old baby. Start young, right? There was no way that this baby would make eye contact with her mother. Now that's so unusual. That is so unusual. Because babies make eye contact all the time. Because the eye, I'm going to talk about in a few moments, the eye is the window of the soul. Eye contact shows the level of surety and solidity and an unconditional acceptance of yourself that you have. When you doubt your eye-ness, when you doubt your wholeness, you don't make eye contact. Your eyes go all over the place except direct eye contact. This child would not make eye contact with this mother, who was a teenage mother, who didn't want the child, who didn't bond with the child. This child was a total interruption in her life. How clever of the child not to make eye contact. Because if I make eye contact with my mother, what will I see? I'll see rejection. She makes eye contact with me. She has not experienced rejection from me. I need now to help the mother, don't I? I need to help the mother to make eye contact with herself. Eye contact. When she makes contact with herself, she'll begin to make contact with the child. If I start with the child, it won't work. I need to start with the mother. I will make contact with the mother or with the child, right? Eye contact. But I need to work with the mother. And for me, you know, when you work with parents, children change. If you work with the children and you don't work with the parents, actually very little happens. Because the parents are the architects. How am I on time, by the way? Where am I? Where's my boss? As soon as I can. Okay. Am I all right? Am I? Okay. So, belonging, right? Belonging, which is the last one down there, is unconditional belonging. There's no other healthy belonging. The over-belonging is where you do everything for the child. I always tell the story about the mother who rang me, you know, Is that Dr. Humphreys? Yeah, this is me. Are you the man who writes the books? Yeah, I'm the man who writes the books. Doctor, I've got a situation here. I don't know whether you can help me or not, but I've got a 30-year-old up in the bed. I was thinking, how lucky, you know? I've got a 30-year-old in the bed and he won't get out of the bed for me. He won't do any work. He won't do any course. He come in drunk most nights. He messes the place. He gets sick. My heart is scalded. And I said, Mrs., that's tough. Not unusual, I said, but that's tough. By any chance at all, Mrs., did you mollycoddle him? Ah, sure, doctor, didn't I do everything for him? And I said, yes, and he needed to learn to be helpless in the face of that. Do you understand? When I get the impression, the thing that my mother needs me for me to need her, I need to be helpless. That's clever, responsive to the child. Because if he comes down the stairs tomorrow morning and he says to her, Mother, stop doing things for me. I was working with a 22-year-old a couple of weeks ago who's deeply depressed, had attempted suicide. And one of the things he said to me, my parents never said no to me. And I really need for them to say no. Yes, he has no sense of power. He feels powerless. He feels helpless when you're allowed, when everything is done for you. That's over-belonging. If he comes down the stairs and said, Mother, stop! Will she say to him, where's the only man? Oh, okay. Will she say to him, right, I've been waiting 30 years for you to say that. Will she say that to him? No, she won't. What will she say? After all I've done for you. The catch cry of the over-belonging Irish mother. Now, the catch cry of the Irish father is, you've ruined him. And my response is, and Dad, if you feel your son was being ruined, where were you? Where were you? Because the absent father is just as contributing to that situation as the over-belonging mother. Because if the father was in a mature place, he would say, he would talk with his wife and say, I'm concerned about how we're actually rearing our child. And we need to rear our child into self-reliance and independence and responsibility for himself, not doing everything for him. Over-belonging. Under-belonging, you're here to live your life for me. Now, you see, the over-belonging is where I live my you must allow me to live my life for you. The under-belonging is the opposite. You must live your life for me. You must be top of the class, be on the best team, right? Get the high results. And I was telling you about the examination student who got the Leaving Cert and she had to go back. Her sister had done her Junior Cert. And the Junior Cert results come out in the middle of September. And they're handed out in school. So this sister of the child who had to go back to, or the young person who had to go back to do her Leaving Cert, she gets her results, she opens them. She looks at them, she turns them down on the table, she walks out of school, she walks down to Kent train station in Cork, and she throws herself in front of a train. Now why did she do that? Why did she do that? Because I won't be good enough. And I'm going to now suffer major rejection if I come in with those results to my mother and father. And remember, please, don't judge the mother and father. What happened to them as children that they can't see their children for themselves and they see their children through examination results. Compassion is very important. And compassion means I maintain relationship with you and I have a deep understanding that something in your story has brought you to that very protected, defensive place. Please do. If you judge, you need more help than the person you're judging. Let me say that again. If you judge, you need more help than the person you're judging. Okay. Over-belonging, under-belonging, no-belonging. What a sad thing that one is, right? If I had time, I'd like to have read you a story, but no-belonging is where neither my person gets recognition nor my behavior. At least in most families, as a child myself, my mother was an invalid, my father was largely absent. I got my recognition, surprise of surprises, by being the carer. I became the parent when I was 5 years of age. I reared my father, I reared my mother, I reared my brothers and sister, even though I was the youngest in the family. And you know that each child has a different mother and each child has a different father. And each one of you has heard me differently here today. And each student in a classroom has a different teacher. And each child in a can't get rid of it. In a, before going to a main school setting, right, each child has a different educator. Every child is an individual, and every child uniquely forms their own relationship with father and mother because they want to maintain their individuality in some way or other. And do you ever see that for, you know, the family of grown-up adults? And they get together for a reunion. Now, what a mistake that word is, because the union breaks down very quickly, doesn't it? We're into our second pint, and we begin to reminisce. And you could swear to God you're hearing about five different families. And of course you are. It's very important to see each child experiences the family, the mother and the father and the brothers and sisters in unique individual ways. And every child needs to be listened to for their story. Don't invent their story for them. Don't try to imagine what's going on for them. Please let them tell you what's going on for them. So the no belonging is very sad. How am I doing? I'm over time. I'm being hung now, am I? This is conditionality, you understand? Yeah. If I don't finish now in about 2 minutes, right, I'm going to be hung, drawn, and quartered as well. Okay. Yeah. Okay. You can read this in some of my books. One of the most recent book is a book called Relationship, 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 Heart of a Mature Society. Let me finish in this one. Belongings are what belongs to me. And the belongings that belong to children and that we need to recognize and we need to affirm and we need to support and we need to encourage are the child is absolutely unconditionally lovable. There's no doubt about that. And that when you need to correct a behavior, be sure you correct a bit of behavior, not the child. And if you find you're losing it, it's because there's something in yourself you need to correct. And be compassionate with yourself and say, I need to look at, why did I get so cross there? You know, why did I shout at the child? Because really it's something in myself I need to look at. I need to be unconditional with myself and I need to be compassionate with myself. But read the signs. Every child is a genius. Now tell me, how many people in this room can honestly put up their hand and say, Tony, sure, listen, you're telling me what I know. I know I'm a genius. How many people? Oh, come on. You know, I've said that in every continent of the world. I've asked thousands of people that question. How many people in this audience can say that they're a genius? There is no limit to our, thank you, there is no limit to one hand, right? There is no limit to our intelligence. Please do not confuse knowledge with intelligence. When a child doesn't show high knowledge of maths and English, that does not mean he lacks intelligence. It just means he's not motivated to learn English and Irish or maths, because he's much more motivated for you to see, I'm coming from a disastrous home. I mean, there was a teacher came to me about our child, because he was very upset. He had bawled her out, a 12-year-old, the day before. This child created havoc. She was great at upsetting the whole school. By the way, that takes genius to upset a whole school. And on this particular day, he lost. Get out of my classroom, get down to the principal, and don't come back. So she goes down to the principal. And the principal is talking at her. You're out of the school. Your education has ended. Your life has ended, right? You know, we can't keep you in the school. And she's swinging the leg. Now, she comes from a social engineering disastrous place in Limerick where there's criminal activity, drug activity. She has not any emotional holding or social holding in that family, and she's kicking the leg, and he's giving out to her, and she says to him, look at my face, look at my face. Am I bothered? How ingenious, how absolutely, and she, of course she's bothered, but nobody's bothering to see what she's bothered about. Of course she's bothered. So we're geniuses. We have immense, I remember I was saying about babies have more intelligence than the rest of us, right? Because they need every bit, every cell when they're born, because the threats are huge. Okay, every child is a creator as well. We are immensely creative. But when there are threats to our development, our creation goes into defenses, ways of trying to get recognition through by being the good boy like I was, or the troublemaker, or the best footballer, or the sick child, because children are amazing at sickness. There's one of the great ways to get attention is to get sick. There's no more powerful way. So we're creators. What the child feels, thinks, says, and does is 100% about the child. It belongs to the child. And it gives you an opportunity to get into his internal world. It is not about you. It is not about anybody else. It is 100% about the child. In the same way, what you think, say, feel, and do is 100% about you. It is not about the child. I remember a father, after some television show, I came out after it, and one of the male presenters came running after me. He said, "Tony, can I have a word?" I said, "Sure." He said, "I don't know whether you can help me or not, but my children are driving me wild." "Yeah," I said, "I can help you. It's not your children who are driving you wild. It's you who's driving yourself wild." He's blaming the children. "What's your need?" I said. He said, "My need is for peace and quiet." I said, "You're in here at 6 o'clock in the morning. This is a breakfast show. You go home at 6 o'clock in the evening. The children have missed you all day. They want a wild time with you. That's their need. What are you doing to look after your own need for peace and quiet? You can make requests to children, but they may not be in a place to meet your request. But your need belongs to you. It doesn't belong to your children. But as long as you think it belongs to your children, you keep blaming them for not meeting your need. That's the underbelonging, by the way." But it was a real revelation for him. It was for him to take responsibility for his own need and not blame his children. Children always know, by the way. They know exactly what's going on. But very few of us ask them about it. They are individuals, and they are powerfully self-reliant at taking care of themselves in the face of all the threats that they encounter. And equally, they are powerfully self-reliant in taking in all the affirmation and love and recognition that they get. They are masters of their universe. But when they're troubled, they've created a defensive world. And when they're secure, they've created an open, secure, loving world. Thank you.